Good morning and welcome to the 2021 LGA ADPH Annual Public Health Conference, Rising to the Challenge. Welcome to all of you at the start of our 2 days of conference, divided into four webinars. So this morning, we've got a great program for you. I'm going to be chairing. I'm Janelle DeGrucci. I'm the president of the Association of Directors of Public Health, and I'm also a director of public health in Tameside in Greater Manchester. Really pleased to welcome you. We've got over 1,000 people registered for this conference. A lot of people who work in local government or who are councillors, representatives from local government. And we've got people from Public Health England and a range of people from other areas connected to public health or indeed even wider. So welcome to everyone for joining us this morning. We've got a lineup, some really excellent speakers joining us over the next couple of days. So it's now been 1 year since all our lives really changed beyond measure, both professionally and public and publicly, socially. During this time, directors of public health and our teams, working closely with colleagues in local government, the NHS, and all other parts of the public health and wider system, have really risen to the challenge that COVID has given us. I think that we've gone above and beyond to protect the health and well-being of the communities that we serve. We are not there yet, but we, as we work towards recovery from COVID, it's not going to be possible until we address the underlying structural inequalities. It's those structural inequalities that are really helping COVID and other viruses to persist. And we owe it to the diverse and disadvantaged communities who've really paid a very high price to create a recovery that addresses our nation's health inequalities. As many of you will know, today also marks the day of national reflection. And because of that, we're going to be finishing our session this morning a couple of minutes early for those of you who want to join the National Minute Silence at midday. As we remember those who have been lost and lost their lives in the pandemic, let's also take the opportunity to reflect on the incredible work of the public health community in our response to the challenges of the past year. Over the course of the conference, we're going to be exploring and building on some of that experience and reflecting on how we can use the learning to ensure that what comes next is both better and fairer. A reminder that the conference material over the next 2 days is going to be available on the LGA website in the next couple of days, and there will be recordings of the sessions available early next week. I'm now pleased to introduce to you our first keynote speaker, Professor Chris Whitty. Chris is an epidemiologist with a background in global health, having worked as a doctor in the UK, Africa, and Asia, working both as a doctor and doing research. He holds an MBA and postgraduate degrees in economics and law. We've all come to know Chris for his central role as our chief medical officer, particularly over the last year. What might be less well known is that Chris is also still practicing as a NHS consultant physician at University College London hospitals. And we know that he definitely spent last Christmas on shift. He's recognized for the style of calm leadership that he's displayed throughout the pandemic. And the directors of public health have been fortunate enough to see Chris every week in our conversations with him. And we absolutely have appreciated the way in which he's responded to the pandemic and supported us in our responses locally. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Professor Chris Whitty, Chief Medical Officer for England and Chief Scientific Advisor for the Department of Health and Social Care. I will encourage you also to, whilst Chris is speaking and subsequently, please do use the question and answer function, because we're going to be hopefully have quite some time for us to engage in questions and answers with Chris. Over to you, Chris.
Thanks very much, Danielle. I mean, building very much on what you've said, I mean, this is, in a sense, this is an important day to look backwards, I think. And that, of course, most of what I'm going to say is going to be looking forwards. But, you know, this is a sad day, really. If we look at the ONS data that came out today, as of end of last week, 147, 179 of our fellow citizens died of COVID. Even if we look at excess mortality, which is slightly lower, so that's in a sense the number in addition to where you would have expected it, they estimate that 111,641 of our fellow citizens died in excess of what you'd have expected over this time, and this is due to this virus. So no public health teams, no local authorities have had to deal with something like this on this scale for a very long time, certainly since any of us were working. So the second point, again, reflecting what you said, which I wholly agree with, is massive thanks to people working as directors of public health in wider public health teams, in Public Health England and in local authorities, because I think that, you know, people have risen remarkably to the challenge, as has the whole UK population, and has been actually a remarkable national effort at both a local and a national level. But it has been not just the bits which I think people see very clearly. So emergency services, obviously doctors, nurses, healthcare workers in hospitals, care home workers, but also schools, also local authorities, who've really stood up a very large amount of the response to this. Across a whole range of different areas, from dealing with protecting those and supporting those who are shielding through to supporting schools and the DPH network itself. But I do want to just, just take a moment to say how impressively the directors of public health and their teams have responded to this, to those who haven't come across them. I think really until this epidemic hit us, many people, even in local authorities and certainly outside them, didn't realise what a key role directors of public health have and wider public health teams. And I think this has really highlighted so strongly why this is so central to the long-term protection of and improvement of the health of our populations. And, you know, I do think that one of the things we need to do as part of our recovery from COVID, we're by no means out of the woods yet, is actually to cement that leadership even more strongly, I think, locally. And also, I think importantly, make sure that some of the links between the local and the national that have been built up don't disappear, because I think there is a real risk of that. In terms of COVID, I could talk at length about where things are going with COVID, but I suspect the great majority of you either already know it, or if you don't know it, it's because you're deliberately choosing not to. I'm really just going to make an obvious point, which is that the path from here on in does look better than the last year, but there are going to be lots of bumps and twists on the road from here on in. There will definitely be another surge at some point, whether it's before winter or in the next winter, we don't know. Variants are going to cause problems. There will be stockouts of vaccines, and no doubt there'll be multiple problems at a national level, but also at a local level, school outbreaks, prison outbreaks, all the things that people are dealing with on a day-to-day basis. I'm very happy to deal with any of those on questions, but I suggest we don't dwell on that at this point. Broadly, though, there were three broad sets of things I wanted to say as this kind of introduction, and then really leave the great majority of the session over to extended answers to questions. The first is just to repeat, but then maybe slightly build on what Janelle said about deprivation. This infection has picked out in stark ways something which everybody on this call knows, which is that ill health follows deprivation. It does for infectious diseases, it does for smoking-related diseases, it does for cardiovascular diseases, it does for cancer. the same areas are really badly hit every single time, and the same people are very badly hit. Sometimes that's geographical. Very largely that's determined by socioeconomic and deprivation indices. Sometimes it's defined by, for example, ethnicity. These existed before COVID, but COVID has really thrown a very strong light on them. What we've had is COVID is most common in these areas. It causes the biggest problem to those once there, so it's therefore led to greater infection incidents for a variety of reasons, including the fact people, for example, can't take time off work. People live in multi-generational households, crowding, a whole bunch of different areas. There's a very, for example, strong gradient between the most urban, semi-urban and rural areas in terms of incidence of COVID. So some of it's not just purely socioeconomic. It's then tended to lead to higher mortality in these groups. And that's largely because of pre-existing comorbidities that we all knew were there, but has made this even more obvious. Smoking-related diseases, for example, obesity, for example. And unfortunately, if you look at vaccine uptake, the people who are the most likely to get COVID and the most likely to die of COVID if they catch COVID are also in aggregate, not at individual level, but in aggregate, actually have lower rates of vaccine uptake at this stage. And we really need to make sure we deal with that, because otherwise what's already an entrenched disparity is going to get even worse over time. That's the first sort of set of comments. I think those are obvious, but I think they still bear repeating. The second point is that the effects of lockdown, we've known right from the beginning the lockdown was going to have really severe effects on many people's health. Absolutely not everybody. For some people, lockdown has either made no difference, or even in some cases, if you actually look at the academic literature and surveys, has even improved life, interestingly. But for many people, physical or mental well-being have been very badly affected by this, ranging from increased levels of domestic abuse, loneliness, particularly in older people who felt very much isolated in their areas. Physical health, people maybe not exercising less, more greater amounts of alcohol consumption, but also, and this will be very important in the long run, people not attending things like screening, so the medical things, attending doctors late with things that they would have gone earlier. This may well have a significant effect on cancers being detected later. But in the very long term, for many people they're who are already on marginal levels of income, marginal levels of deprivation, lockdown, potential for losing jobs, the reduction in income associated with furloughing and so on, all of which the state in multiple ways through local authorities and national government have tried to reduce, but reduce and not eliminate. And there'll be many people who were close to deprivation and now will have been shoved further into it by the effects of lockdown and all the things we've had to do. So there is going to be a very big job of work to do in terms of recovery. And these are going to hit, in particular, people in their early working lives. So these effects could, if we're not very careful, be lifelong, and that'll be exacerbated by reductions in face-to-face learning in school and indeed in college for further education and universities, which are one of the most powerful engines for reducing deprivation over generations. So there's going to be a long rain shadow to COVID, which all of us will be dealing with, and many of these are going to land in the responsibilities of local authorities rather than the national government in terms of how we respond to them and how we best recover from them. So that is really quite a serious set of issues that I think we are going to have to deal with for quite a while. The final set of comments I just wanted to make were really just to reflect on what we could do better, could have done better, and could do better in the future. On the could have done better and what we could have done better in the pandemic, there'll be a lot to learn on that. And I personally really welcome that. I think there's a lot we could do better in the future by learning from what we didn't do right this time round. And certainly there are lots of things which, you know, if I was rerunning things again, I would do differently. I'm sure that's true actually for everyone on this call. Knowing what we know now, we would do it differently. This, as with almost any situation where you're really doing things from a standing start. But I thought excuse me. There were two other, I have just had my, yesterday had my COVID test. I'm confident it's not that. I had two other things that I just wanted to highlight. Place has obviously been really important for COVID. If you look at the maps of COVID, they are very highly geographically focused, but that has tended to move around, and it's tended to move around for a variety of different reasons. At any given point in time, if the bits of the country that are most affected have been different, but certain areas have come back repeatedly time and again to a situation where they were in particularly badly affected with COVID, and that is still the case. For example, Leicester all the way through had very significant issues. Blackburn with Darwin all the way through has had very significant issues. Other places have had been really badly affected for particular points in time, and then less so over other time points in time. And inevitably, the areas that have been badly affected have tended to have things that are in common. And this is my sort of my main point on this, is the things that are in common are do not naturally fit in historical county local authority boundaries. So many of the problem sets we see from COVID, but this is true for all the other health problems we see, and we're gonna have to tackle in the future, they often are geographically localized, but dispersed across the country. An example in a slightly different area that I'm looking at the moment from my annual report for this year is coastal towns, for example. The problems of coastal towns are much more in common with one another than with their nearest inland town in the local authority. So we need to be thinking about place, not just in terms of kind of area of the country, but also problem sets where place-based issues of health are repeated in multiple parts around the country. What should be our national strategy for that? How should the local and the national public health interventions work? And I think COVID is an example of that, but there are very many others. And the final bit of this section I just wanted to comment on was science and research. If you look at COVID, I was confident right from the beginning that the only way out of this was going to be science and research. And the reason for that is that has been true for every single major problem we've had in health back over centuries. The way you actually move from where we are now to where we could be is by improving science and research. And I think if we look at public health research in general, it's probably slightly less strong than it could be in the UK in terms of practical responses, some very good academic work, but in terms of things that actually answer practical issues. And much of the research that's done is not done in the places which have got the biggest health problems. You know, there should be far more research going on in Wigan and in Blackpool and in Skegness than there is in North Oxford, but that's not actually what you see. So we really need to have a much stronger engagement, and local authorities have historically not had anywhere near the kind of interactions with the research and academic areas that has been the norm in the NHS. And I think this is an area we really need to look at. I think COVID has been a very powerful illustration that when you have a serious problem, actually for very many of the issues, you're only going to find one way to get out of it, and that's to research your way out of it. And there are many other areas where I think we could do the same, which we currently are not. So I think that's an area we really all could do a lot better. And I say that as head of the National Institute for Health Research, so that's wearing my other hat. But I go back to my first point, which is really a huge thanks to everybody on this call and all the people you work with. It has been a depressing, but very, very remarkable collective effort by local authorities and people in the widest possible public health community led by directors of public health. And I think people, you know, those who know about it are immensely grateful. Everyone else should be very grateful. It has been a terrible year, but it would have been a lot worse if it wasn't for the work of so many people on this call and your colleagues.
Thanks, Chris, for those that opening points for us. It has stimulated a lot of questions coming in. We'll try and group them. And perhaps group them in a way to look at the key points that you've made as well. So if we were to take the point around something around COVID and the point you've just made, how can we ensure that expertise and knowledge and experience of the local system is at the heart of developing national policy. So you mentioned that those connections, those relationships have been really important as we've developed a system approach. How can we ensure that that continues, that two-way exchange of expertise and knowledge?
Well, I think a lot of this is that I think that if you look at the sort of tripartite relationship between national government, local government and the NHS, there have always been frictions between those three points in the triangle that actually is what supports the health of all of our fellow citizens. And by national government, I'm including, for the sake of argument, Public Health England. I accept they're not part of government, but they are part of the central national response, but with some regional presence. I think we need to look at that. You know, there is going to be a significant reorganisation of the public health system. I think we need to make sure in doing that that we strengthen rather than make weaker the links between the local and the national on this, because there's a ton of stuff which cannot be done from the centre and can only be done locally. Equally, that's true the other way around. There's a bunch of stuff which actually is much easier done nationally, or, and I go back to my other point, done as seeing problem sets as local, but actually repeated over multiple localities, where there actually there should be a genuine national strategy for whatever the problem is. So I think it's really responsibility of everybody on this call, obviously me from a national perspective, but all of you on the call as well, to make sure that in the reorganisations that are going to come, and no one loves a good reorganisation if they got any kind of sense, but you know they happen from time to time for perfectly understandable reasons. And when they happen, I think we should take this as an opportunity to strengthen rather than weaken the links. We've got to do that, I think, because I think this has really shown why that's important.
Okay. And in terms of there are some things that need to be done nationally, as opposed to locally. So one of the questions is in terms of recovery, is it inequalities that we're talking about, is it time for universal basic income or something similar to be part of the COVID, post-COVID response? So what's that national policy response?
So one of the few areas that I steer well clear of, well, there are two things I always steer clear of, things I think are party political, which this isn't, and things which are to do with money in public. In private, I have views and express them to ministers. And the reason for that is I think that's actually properly the role of politicians, local and national, to determine budgets. So I don't comment on them. The general principle, though, that what we need to do is ensure that people who are on the lowest incomes are supported, I think is an uncontroversial, absolutely central point of public health. And in a sense, there's quite a fall off, actually. It's not though people would imply that this is important at all stages, this really makes its biggest difference for people who are in the most deprived areas. And relatively small changes in economic situations can have really quite profound effects, positive or negative, on their health prospects and indeed generational life prospects. So I mean, there are lots of mechanisms by which you can address that. Universal basic income, it happens to be one of them, but it's not the only one. But the general principle that this is an important area, I don't think is in any sense controversial. It clearly is true.
Okay, thanks, Chris. There are a set of questions about some of the key learning points from the pandemic. For instance, when we went into lockdown, one of the key points last September, when the second wave started to hit us, could we have gone in sooner? Could there have been clearer rules? Could we have done it differently in terms of students coming back? So there are a number of questions saying, you know, could we have done it better? So do you, you said about learning, lots to learn. What's your approach on how we should go about doing that?
Well, I think, I mean, I would divide in terms of, you know, things you would run differently. If we had the knowledge and the information systems we have now, let's take the first lockdown, the second lockdown, different responses on this. On the first lockdown, our fundamental problem was we simply didn't know what we were dealing with. We only realized quite how fast the wave was developing at the point when people started dying in hospitals, basically. Because we, you know, if we had the kind of testing system we have now, we'd have spotted this wave far further out in time and been able to judge it rather more carefully. I think the difference in timing would have been relatively small, but it might have been significant. We didn't actually have any experience in a Western democracy in the last century of having done anything like lockdown to try and achieve these kind of things. So we didn't actually know how it would work. As it turns out, people responded to it magnificently, and it had the effect that we were hoping it would, but that wasn't actually a given at the point we started. There were a bunch of things we didn't, we overestimated what portion of transmission was from people who were symptomatic, which was a misunderstanding from SARS. It's an example of where actually you kind of look at the examples you've got and actually you draw a line through the dots, but that isn't always right. But I think that the decisions in the first wave were largely to do with the lack of information and the lack of knowledge. And the replaying of that would be different were we to have understood what was going to happen next. I think in the second wave, it was slightly more complicated because I think the economic and social effects of lockdown, which I talked about earlier, were always in tension with the COVID effects of having a lockdown. And I think anyone who claims that those two are not in tension has failed to understand even the public health issues, leaving aside the wider societal ones. So it was always going to be quite a difficult issue on the second one. And that was less about us not understanding where we were on the pandemic, although a surprisingly large number of people in public life, and I'm not meaning the government here, I'm talking more widely, to be clear, don't seem to understand what an exponential curve is. And this includes people who have economics in their title, for example, and which seems a bit surprising. So, you know, don't understand that once an epidemic starts going, it is either doubling or halving. And if you're doubling, you're going to get from small numbers to scary numbers surprisingly fast. But of course, the really big changes tend to be backloaded, so you can see the wave coming out. So I think there's a combination of an inability of some people to understand how exponential curves work. I say this isn't a point about government, this is a point about the wider societal response, and the difficulty of essentially balancing large numbers of societal, and different people would say that. I think there's lots of people would say at the time how they have balanced it, and then there's lots of people who say after the event, having seen how things turned out, how they balance them. Maybe they're the same, maybe they're different. I think they vary depending on people. We've also always had a really vigorous debate with outriders on either side. There's always been some people who said you shouldn't lock down at all, and they said it all the way through, right from before first lockdown. This is the wrong scientific approach. These are scientists I'm talking about. And people who said we should lock down early and hard and stay locked down the whole time. We should be aiming for zero deaths. And where we've ended up is some point between those, which is where I think the bulk of scientific and technical opinion is. But to be aware, those debates have been in the technical press as well. There hasn't been a science view and a political view. There has been a range of scientific view with a midpoint, and there's been a range of political view with a midpoint. And I think how, you know, I could give a very long answer as to how that's played out. I think there'll be time to do that. I'm just making the obvious point that actually I think the idea that there was a right answer. The final thing I'd say on this is I would divide things that I would do differently into the areas where we had the right science, but we didn't have the data. So the models as to how the epidemic was going to work were actually pretty accurate. It's just that we didn't realize where we were on the epidemic curve. That was lack of data rather than the science being right. And ones where the scientific opinion has changed, either because the data has changed, like the degree of asymptomatic transmission, or because the scientific consensus has changed, like the importance of face masks, where actually the science hasn't changed itself, to be honest, but where scientists believe the midpoint of the debate is has shifted quite a lot over the course of the epidemic. So there's a lot of reasons why we've changed. You know, if we were giving the same advice again, we would have given a different set of advice. And sometimes it's just we know more, and sometimes it's we knew the right science, we didn't have the data to fill in the gaps. I could go on, but that's probably enough for now.
Well, I suppose that there's a few questions then that flow from that. So People had flu pandemic plans in place. We had lots of plans in place. Were those plans not adequate? Were they not the right plans? So there's some question around that. And then another question is, in terms of our response, and that local government, environmental health officers, public health teams, PHE teams, this is bread and butter, and used to doing infectious disease control and outbreak management and so on, but didn't seemingly weren't utilized, used to the degree to which they felt they should be used. And that's frustrating. Although, are there lessons around for us around our planning, our plans, what we have in place, the use of a public health system already in place? There's a bit there where people are feeling, well, isn't that what we could have learned?
Yeah. So on the should we have used local more at the beginning? I think the short answer is yes. But the rather longer answer is, when you're trying to stand up a capacity from a standing start, it almost always starts off being done in a centralized way. In part, that's just because it's easier to do that if you're trying to do it from the center. And in part, if I'm honest, it's also because capacity varies across the country. And if we'd done it entirely on a local basis, we would have actually found some areas were in much better shape than others, just because of pre-existing skill sets, pre-existing capacity, and a whole bunch of other areas. The advantage of doing it nationally is at least you don't end up with that situation where you often even entrench some of the problems you've got because of relative local issues. Now, that wasn't actually the reason it was done. It was primarily for the first reason, that it was much easier to do it, to do stuff at speed, because even if we'd utilized all of the local capacity, what we didn't have was the testing capacity and all of the things that needed to go with that. And for a disease which has got an incredibly non-specific syndrome incredibly common, moving extraordinarily fast, in the absence of testing, your ability, you know, the ability to contact trace is kind of neither here nor there. You're gonna have to test, or you're not going to be able to do this. And it was the standing up the testing capacity that was really the rate limiting step at the beginning, rather than the trace bit of test and trace. I think you arguably could have done more locally, and probably should have done more locally. The test bit, that was always going to have to be done at a central level in the UK environment. Some other countries that had a larger testing industry were able to do it in a more, basically by handing it over to the private sector, were able to do it in a more dispersed way than the UK was, but we didn't really have that ability, or at least certainly didn't think we did it at that point in time.
Thanks, Chris. And if we can just take one or two questions on vaccination, and then there are quite a lot of questions coming in about moving forward and future, but there are still just on vaccination, just perhaps say a little bit. There's questions about, well, how does the JCVI prioritisation work when, for instance, the question mentions the prison outbreaks, and why didn't we get ahead and vaccinate prisoners? And then there's another question around supply and the up and down of supply, and will the UK become self-sufficient in developing its enough vaccine, its own supply, so that we don't have to deal with other countries supplying it to us?
Yeah, well, on prisons, I mean, the thing with the vaccine rollout was the reason JCVI took the initial set of decisions based on age plus disease, multi-morbidity and other issues, I think was incontrovertibly right. And that's because the number needed to vaccinate at the top end of the age range is about 20, and the number needed to vaccinate once you get below 50 is about 8,000 to avert one death. This is so predictable in terms of who's going to die, that until you've vaccinated all the people who are at very high significant risk of mortality, and you can predict with 99% certainty who they will be, because 99% of them were in very highly defined groups, it made complete sense to do that. So that's JCVI's list, groups 1 through 9, which is what we're still going through. And I actually think most people who make counter arguments, if they were on JCVI, fundamentally would have made the same decision. I think they would find it difficult to sustain one. I think the question about what to do once we get below JCVI layer 9 is rather more open to discussion. And I think different people could come to different views about this. There still remains quite a strong age differential in terms of severe disease, less of mortality, but your probability of getting a hospitalization and getting onto ICU is still very heavily determined by age, plus some very pre-obvious conditions. So I think the argument and the main reasons that JCVI went for age were twofold. One was that this is at least a very straightforward way of actually defining who's at greatest risk. And the second was actually to do with speed. That the way that this is most easily, this disease is going to most easily be brought under reasonable control, not complete control for the foreseeable future, is to get the maximum number of people vaccinated. So essentially the first group of vaccinations to stop people dying, the second group of vaccinations we're still in is to stop people being hospitalized and having severe disease, plus some deaths. The third group of vaccination will do that, but actually you're also the great majority of the transmission occurs in people under 50 and over 15, so in that age range. That's by far the bulk, and that's what drives the epidemic. So, should you within that go for particular groups or particular geographies? Well, the issue here, because I get emailed about this on at least a daily basis by different groups, I'm aware of this, is that there are almost infinite numbers of groups who can make a perfectly legitimate case based either on vulnerability, on geography, on, as you say, with prison outbreaks, or, you could say the same about meat packing, you could say the same about fruit picking. There's a whole bunch of different things which are clearly associated either with vulnerability to disease or vulnerability to of mortality. And some of those choices are pretty fine choices. What everybody who makes the choice, and I've been pretty firm about following JCVI advice rather than trying to deviate from it, they all make the case as to why their particular group should get it. Very few of them are prepared to make the case as to why another group should therefore not get it. And it's the zero-sum nature of this at the moment because of the number of vaccines you've got, which I think is really quite important to think through. If you say yes to one group, by definition, you're saying no to some other group. In terms of the supply, what we really should all want is a global supply that is sufficient for global need. And in an ideal world, that would mean we didn't worry about borders because there'll be so much supply that actually doesn't matter one way or the other. The reason that we will probably end up with greater supply is partly because that's good for the world. I mean, we clearly have demonstrated an insufficient capacity to do this at speed and high quality. So I would be very much in favour of the UK having greater capacity all the way through the vaccine chain, and remembering that it's not just, there's a whole bunch of different steps to that. And with the current model, if you look at most of the vaccines we're using, they cross national boundaries multiple times between the first stage of the process and the point it actually gets into someone's arm. So, the fill and finish is often very different from where the batches are made, are different from where it's tested and so on. In terms of nations. Now, is it a good thing that every country aims to have national self-sufficiency on this? Actually, probably not. What we really want is a system where globally there is complete sufficiency, but at the moment it is sensible for the UK, given that there is global insufficiency, to be aiming for maximum internal capacity over the maximum number of platforms, because we are one of the countries that's able to do this and hopefully do this for the world as well as just for the UK. I certainly would regret a situation where you only got vaccines from your own country and that's the way it had to work. I don't think that's an efficient or appropriate way to respond. But I certainly am very strongly in favour of the UK having greater capacity.
Thanks, Chris. So moving on from learning from COVID, the inequalities element, and moving forward, question about how we can use this time to refocus local government and place-based public health and wellbeing back to the centre of local government. So currently a lot of focus on adult and children's social care, and indeed on money going to those services, money going into the NHS, So high cost, high demand areas, but do we need to refocus local government back to health and well-being like they were 80 years ago, perhaps reaffirmed through legislation? And the questioner, it's Trudy Grant, DPH Somerset, says you've been an absolute star throughout all of this. Can't wait to shake your hand. So I just thought I'd add that into the end of her. She snuck that one in on her question. But it is about local government itself, in essence, being there to serve the public's health and well-being in a broader sense, rather than the money focus on high demand areas, whether it's social care or indeed NHS.
Yeah, so the difficulty really here, and this has always been the problem, it's true, it's a real problem at national level as well, and anyone in public health recognises this, is that the urgent crowds out the important but long term. And if you're in the central health system, the fact that wait times in A&E are going up is much more likely to hit the news than the fact that actually screening services aren't quite what they could be until something really badly goes wrong. Smoking cessation services are weak. Now, if you do kind of pounds per impact on health, many of these other areas are far more effective viewed over a long period of time. So if you take them over a 20-year period, many of these areas have a much bigger impact. But the nature of most discourse in the public is around the here and now. And that's not particularly surprising. Now, COVID actually almost is the wrong answer on this one, because COVID, in fact, is all about the here and now. It's about trying to get on top of stuff where we've got an epidemic, we've got to get on top of it both immediately and also to try and stop it coming back again. And so the great majority of our focus has been on issues that are about trying to prevent people dying in the next 3 weeks and then preferably in the next 3 months. As I say, some of the effects of lockdown, for example, are going to have their negative impacts over many years, and in some cases, decades. And it's those kind of issues that I think often get lost. And so I think what we really have to do is always go back to what is the area under the curve. And actually something which has a 10% effect, but only for 3 months, will often have a much smaller health impact than something that has a 2% impact, but actually is over a lifetime. Every year repeating that 2% impact. And, often something like primary education is more important for health in many cases than, something which actually has, major heart operation or something of that sort. So I think it's very important that we prove that with well-done research and then make that point over and over again to those who are making decisions and basically show them the maths and say, fundamentally, if you want to improve the lot of our citizens viewed over a lifetime, it's actually not always the thing which is very, very quick that's going to give you the big impact for the same pound spent. It's actually very often these rather lower key, but longer wave issues.
Yeah, and I guess with the vaccine hesitancy among certain groups around trust in the system, trust in the public health system, or even the NHS, that does play out even in the immediacy of COVID, doesn't it? I mean, how do we build back that, unequal experience of public service and therefore that distrust, which is actually, then you can see it whether it's COVID vaccine, but actually there's so much more there, isn't there?
Well, I think that if you look at people's lack of reduced enthusiasm to take up vaccines, it's a marker for usually lack of engagement, often for very understandable reasons, over multiple other areas of health and indeed wider society. And I think if our response to some groups having lower vaccine uptake is simply to get them vaccinated, well, I mean, that'll help us a bit in the short run, but I think that's a huge wasted opportunity. They are absolutely the same groups. This is an opportunity to engage with them. I mean, some ethnic minority groups will be an example of this. This is actually an opportunity to engage with them on wider health issues. And it should be seen as the start of a conversation rather than it is the conversation. The vaccine's in your arm twice, now that's it, your job done. I think that would be an error. If I can use an anecdote just to illustrate this from my previous life, when we were trying to get people in northern Nigeria to have polio vaccination, and we said to them, why won't you be vaccinated against this? They would basically say, well, this is a very rare disease. All we see is twice a year, the government appears in white Land Rovers and tries to vaccinate us. In between whiles, we have no no health system, we have no primary school system. Why should we trust the government now? And that's a very fair question. So, you know, the reason that people don't trust the system is based on long-standing experience. And actually, this is a marker for these are the groups we've got to engage with. So I think it should be seen very much in that way.
Right. So moving on to the science and research element. So how can local government be more involved in public health research? How do we go about doing that? How do we improve it? And in those areas where we're already, perhaps struggling a bit in terms of capacity and capability?
Well, my experience of local government, which is far less than most people on this call, is that it is genuinely evidence-based, but with a very, very weak capacity to undertake and indeed to analyse quite a lot of data, which is one of the areas where central government, essentially, I think, can genuinely help. Most people who are involved in local government, whether it's on the political or on the administrative and official side, will be living in the same place for the rest of their lives. And that's quite different from here. They therefore have a very strong interest in taking a long-term view about how do we improve health of our society, because that's where their children will grow up, it's where they will end up probably being buried eventually, or cremated, or whatever their chosen exit from the world is. So I think that what we need to do is, harness that and say, well, look, research is actually a long-term thing. It's primarily about what is the best way to spend the money we've got. And all local authorities are about trying to maximize the impact of the very limited resources very often that are available. And we shouldn't expect local authorities either to have the internal capacity — that's what the academic sector is there for, government doesn't have the internal capacity either, no matter, central government — nor to have the resources. That's what the funding agencies are for. So the funding agencies should put the money on the table, and the universities should be incentivized to go and work with local authorities, and then local authorities have to invite them in and say, these are our problems, will you help us with these, and we will give you access and we will help you to do it administratively and we will help guide the questions, and now get on with it. And then the academic sector can do that. Now, we've started to make some tentative starts with that. So NIHR, for example, has put money on the table for research that can only be unlocked if people do it in collaboration with a local authority. So that's a start. I would, though, like to get much more to the situation we have in the NHS, where it's completely normal that people have joint academic NHS appointments. For almost my entire career, that's what I've had. And that's very normal in the NHS system. It's very rare, actually, in the local authority system. No reason why that shouldn't be the case. And the final point I make is that I think it is important that when people do this, they don't just assume they have to do it with their local university or higher technical college, whatever it might be. You may have the best one on your doorstep for the particular problem you've got, or you may not. And the right thing to do, in England and the UK wider, we're a small country. And actually, one of the side effects of COVID is actually by Zoom and Teams, we can, in fact, do the great majority of the stuff without even having to travel. I'm used to doing research in different continents, so the idea that it's difficult to do two counties away has always struck me as mad. And if the best researcher is in York or the best researcher is in Truro, well, we should be going to get them and get them to solve the problem. So if the alcohol unit in Newcastle should be helping with problems in Wigan, it doesn't have to be Wigan College. Wigan may well be able to help Newcastle with a different set of problems. So I think what we should be doing is we should be much more adventurous about this, aiming to go for the best people in the country, challenging the research funders to put the money in for it so that it is funding neutral to the council, and then saying to the universities, you've got to do this. And I think if we do that, we could really be transformational and have more joint appointments. I think we could really feel very, very different and feel much more like a joint endeavour rather than academic swooping in and swooping out. And I think, as I say, I think if I had a single ask of local authorities, it would probably be to be imaginative about the possibility of joint appointments, where the research side of it is paid for by someone else, but where actually the fact they're embedded in the system allows them people to understand the questions and then to have access to the information they need.
Chris, thanks. And I guess it's not just public health, is it? There's a question from Claire Bartram. As a qualified social worker, working in ADES, struck by your points about deprivation and the need for local government to raise the bar about research. So my question is about the involvement of social work research in this and how to strengthen practical social work research at a local authority level.
Well, I mean, I think social work research, and the only reason I majored on public health is because this is jointly sponsored by the Associate Directors of Public Health, but I completely agree on social care. And if we were to look at although there's a less public health research than I think there should be domestically, if you look at social care research and social work research, it's just a fraction of a percent of what it should be, given the importance of the problem. I mean, given the huge sums involved and the enormous impact on people's lives, the amount of research that goes on in this area is pathetically small. And I think we should all feel, and I feel as a funder of researchers through the NIHR, a real sense of failure on that actually. And now you can't suddenly turn it from being very small to being very vibrant and large. But the key thing is you've got to start somewhere. And I think if anybody on this call knows people who wish to do good social care research, coming from a social work background or indeed any other background, we would be desperate to talk to them, because this is an area we absolutely have to do not just a bit better, but massively better. There's a huge deficit between where we should be, and quite a small amount of money would actually go really quite a long way on this. So I think this is not actually about money resource. I don't think that's the limitation in this particular area at all. In terms of the research, it's much more about the ideas and getting people to actually engage seriously on this.
Thanks, Chris. And there's another question from Debbie Laycock, who's also flagged up about charity and community sector and how they've stepped up, often in really difficult circumstances when funding has been a real issue. We've worked very closely with our colleagues in the charity and community sector. So how can we ensure post-COVID that the potential of that sector as well is fully realised and seen as an equal partner in improving public health and tackling health inequalities?
Well, I think just to finish off on the last question, then on slightly, a very large amount of the best research in the UK is funded by the charity sector, who've been absolutely hammered by COVID, because many of their main funding mechanisms, marathons and charity shops and so on, have absolutely dried up in this period. So they are in deep trouble, a lot of them. Not all, it depends entirely on the funding model, but then so is the delivery side. And I completely agree with the tenor of the question. Now, within the charity sector, it's an incredibly varied sector, charity and voluntary sector more widely, ranging from ones which are incredibly niche and highly technically competent. There are some that are incredibly niche, very good at what they do, but actually research and more technical side aren't what they are. And then there are very, very large ones which really have the capacity to do a huge number of things, some of which are engaging in really strong technical debate, and some of which, if I'm honest, are not. And I think that's a shame, because if you don't engage in a strong debate and probably back it up with some research where there are gaps, then you're condemning yourself to never improve on where you are at the moment. And I think there are some areas where actually I think we could do better, if I'm honest. But I mean, the charity sector and the voluntary sector in the UK is one of the UK's great glories. And if you look around the world, there are very few other countries, and the ones that do are surprising, Bangladesh or some of the countries in Latin America, you wouldn't necessarily immediately think of. There are some other countries that have got as strong a third sector, charity sector, voluntary sector influence, but not many actually. So the UK is very fortunate in this, and I think we should make full use of it.
Thanks, Chris. And I can see it's been a fascinating conversation with you and great questions. So in the last minute or two, there's a question: is it possible for the sake of well-being to provide some positive statistics on recovery rates? So I guess giving you the opportunity to comment on, finish with some positive thoughts about how we're going to take this forward over the next year.
Well, I mean, I think I'll give two positive thoughts. I mean, the first one is that even before we had vaccines and much better drugs and things, the great majority of people with COVID did make a full recovery. And the aim of what we're doing at the moment is to make sure that that ratio is massively improved, and it will be already because of the vaccination program and also the things like dexamethasone and toxilizumab and all these other treatments. So your probability of surviving COVID are much better now in March 2021 than they were if you caught it in March 2020, much better through prevention and treatment overall. And our ability to keep the NHS running with COVID has much improved. So it's not just the direct effects, but the indirect effects on the wider health system. If you look at the number of people in hospital in COVID on the first wave, it was much smaller than the second wave, and yet more non-COVID work happened in the second wave. You know, it's a great tribute to our colleagues working in the NHS. So I think, and then the final point on that is, you know, science has taken us a very long way in a year. It's quite extraordinary, really, when you think about where we were, how far we've got on prevention, treatment, understanding, modelling, all these kind of things. So I feel very positive about the future, but very positive doesn't mean we won't have quite a lot of problems between now and when we get to the point we think actually we're now in steady state with this virus, and we are quite some way from that. So I want to be very positive about what we have achieved, including massive, again, thanks to everyone on the call, and very positive about what we've learned and will continue to learn about this, but without being too Panglossian about the fact that it's all over now and you know, this is just done. I'm afraid there's quite a way to go before we get to the point we say, actually, this is just now where it's going to be.
Great, Chris. Well, thanks. We've a lot of questions. Thanks very much, everyone, for your questions have come in. Some comments about your leadership, Chris, and thanks very much. Incredible leadership over the last year. And that it has felt, and certainly the conversation this morning, that it's been a real team of teams. You know, we've mentioned a lot of players within that team, their environmental health, social care, voluntary charity sector, academics. It's really been that whole approach together. Led by yourself, Chris. So thanks so much for taking the time to come and speak to us. I hope that you've enjoyed the interaction with 1,000 people, even though we can't quite see everyone. but it's been really good and set us off for the next few years in terms of our focus. So thank you very much.
You know, crises have many, many downsides. One of the few upsides is they tend to create links you didn't previously have. I think the links between me and our team, the other DCMOs, and the directors of public health are much stronger as a result of this than they would have been otherwise, which I'm really grateful for, and to your leadership, Janelle. I hope we can continue. What it has unfortunately made more difficult is getting to know, which I was beginning to do, local authority colleagues more widely. So it's reduced the ability to travel around the country and meet people. And that certainly we need to continue, I think. But I just thanks so much to everybody for what they're doing. It's just amazing.
Thanks, Chris. And of course, implicit in what I've been saying, but I know I haven't been explicit, is Public Health England colleagues who are on the call today. I mean, we absolutely wouldn't, you know, it's a public health system. So although we've mentioned local government, I think because of it's the LGA ADPH conference, but without our Public Health England colleagues, as a public health system, you know, we absolutely need to maintain that as we go forward. And as you said, Chris, strengthen that us.
Yeah, totally agree. And I think when people write the histories of this, Public Health England will actually be seen as one of the good guys on this, one of the real heroes in this. They've done an absolutely terrific job.
Absolutely. So that's a good note on which to end. So thanks again to yourself and colleagues. We'll end this part of the morning at this point, and we'll go on to the next session, which will be on public opinion and public health. So thanks again, Chris. And you'll have me, I think, chairing the next session as well. Unfortunately, Councillor Kemp, I don't think, has been able to make it. We'll move on then, I think, into the next session. So we've got, please do use the Q&A We'll take questions as they come, but we are going to have input from Ben Page, who's Chief Exec of Ipsos Mori, Professor Linda Bold, who's Prof of Public Health and Co-Director of Usher Institute in Edinburgh, and Cordelia Hay, who's Associate at Britain Thinks. So I'm really looking forward to the next part of the session. I will delighted to have Ben and Linda and Cordelia with us. So they're going to show, I think they all three of you are using presentations, I think. So we'll start with you having your presentation up. You've each got 10 minutes. And so that will take us to 25 past 11. And then we're going to have Q&A. So please feel free to start putting your questions in as we go through. So first of all, over to Ben.
Thank you very much, Janelle. And I was just going to briefly look at what we've learned, because a year ago we were measuring concern about the pandemic around the world, and about 50% of people in Britain at this point a year ago believed that most of the media coverage about the pandemic was fake news. Well, they don't think that now, of course. And so it's been, you know, we've certainly seen some massive shifts over the last year. I think the main point that I would say is, despite social media, despite the COVID research group on in the Commons, the right-wing Conservative MPs, overall, what we've seen throughout the pandemic is a high level of concern. I mean, you can see that the proportion of people who are very concerned, and in polling terms, being very concerned rather than just mildly concerned, is something. You can see that it stayed pretty high throughout the summer, even as the deaths fell from the first peak. And it's only been recently with the pandemic, with the vaccine rollout, that it started to fall back. So I think one of the interesting things, which again wasn't expected by some of the behavioral specialists at the beginning of the pandemic, was people's actual willingness to take public health measures seriously. And although there are small demonstrations about it, and although you can go onto YouTube and Facebook and find people saying there's a, you know, it's all fake, a plandemic, et cetera, et cetera, what we've generally seen is pretty high levels of compliance. And in fact, by a margin of between, and at various points, 4-1 or 3-1 during the pandemic, the public believing that the measures the government had put in place were not strict enough rather than too strict. So I think, you know, the public have pulled together in a way that's incredibly strong. They are very, there is a, in some ways you might say, an excess of caution, but given that we are 126,000 people dead, you can understand perhaps where they're coming from. So that's where, that's one of the things that we've learned. In terms of the messaging, I think the early messaging, stay home, protect the NHS, save lives, was by far the most successful. And later on in the year, when we moved to more mixed messaging, to tiers, to some regions in lockdown, as opposed to the national lockdown we have now, that was seen as much more difficult to understand, and of course encouraged people to perhaps be a bit more, a bit less compliant. But overall, people very serious about it. As Chris has already said, the impacts have tended to follow existing inequalities. This is just a piece of analysis that Andy Haldane at the Bank of England did with some of our data, showing that if you're a knowledge worker or an administrative worker able to work remotely and who kept your job, you will actually have tended, particularly if you were better paid, you will have tended to save money. So people earning over 55 grand increase their savings, but people on the lowest forms of income have been hardest hit. And I think that's a major challenge. In terms of mental health, women have suffered more than men throughout the pandemic. And it's clear that women took the bulk of work domestically. When you take a household with children in it, women reported spending 47% of their time looking after the home and the house and the family, and men in the same household only 30% of their time. So as always, women had it harder. It is worth saying that anxiety among women is generally reported as higher than men in most ONS data before the pandemic. So although women have certainly had more stress and strains in 2020, they generally do for all sorts of reasons around income and insecurity. And of course, physical activity fell. And this is the first time I've put race into this. This is the survey we do looking at physical activity around Britain every year. And you can see that particularly people from Black and Asian backgrounds, less likely to be physically active, and particularly Black and Asian men. So again, the effects, as we know, are not equal. They have fallen on different ethnic groups more harshly. And the long-term consequences of the pandemic will fall on particular regions of the country, particular neighborhoods, and particular groups, which is, you know, is very, very clear. The other thing I would say is that although we were very worried about vaccine hesitancy, and the work that we're doing globally with Gavi and with the World Economic Forum, what we've seen in Britain is the proportion of people wanting to have the vaccine go up as the vaccine has been rolled out. So concerns in September, October last year that the program of vaccinations had been rushed, that the medicine wasn't, the drugs were not, you know, the vaccine wasn't fully tested, it had been produced too quickly. And what we've now seen since the successful rollout of the vaccine is generally rising acceptance across all communities, although, as we've already discussed, there are groups who with lower levels of acceptance of the vaccine, which is going to be a real challenge in terms of communication. And that does reflect the people who distrust the vaccine are people who also distrust government generally. And they tend to be younger. They tend to be people who make a heavy reliance on social media. You're about three times more likely to believe that this is all a global conspiracy to vaccinate people if you get most of your news from Facebook or YouTube. And so there's a sort of intersectionality of youth, of ethnicity, et cetera, in some of the groups that we will be finding harder to reach as the vaccine program progresses. But overall, if you look at how Britain compares to other countries, we are very, very different in our attitudes, at least to France. We don't have the history of the French do with some vaccination programs. I think it's also worth saying, however, when you look at this data, that people's perceptions and attitudes, as we know very, very well at Ipsos Mori, do not always relate to behavior. So the fact that France had only 29% saying they would take the vaccine in September does not mean that ultimately the French won't get vaccinated. If you look at their measles, mumps, and rubella vaccinations, I was talking to colleagues at the Gates Foundation, it is not sort of massively, massively lower. Yes, they have some pockets, but certainly the British are positive about the vaccine. We're also positive about public services being able to adapt. Early on in the pandemic, people were most critical of care homes, unjustifiably, because they were receiving people untested from hospitals to clear out the NHS. So they were most negative looking across the public sector at care homes. But overall, we've now got most people, you know, confidence about the NHS after a difficult January is high. We saw, and of course, some of the nightly broadcasts by the BBC from NHS hospitals were, of course, deliberate to get people adequately concerned about the January wave. But overall, people pretty positive, most negative about civil servants handing out benefits, and civil servants generally more positive a bit about local government, but particularly, of course, the NHS. So finally, in terms of where NHS and health spending should go now, of course, they're focusing on the waiting times for operations. They're thinking about resourcing. 78% of people, including the majority of Conservative voters, say that the 1% pay rise for the NHS was not enough. But unfortunately, with public health, as it well knows, something of a Cinderella service, we've got rather fewer people talking about reducing inequalities in health in society, just around one in five saying that should be a priority. And I think that's just a reminder of some of the challenges we have as a country before the pandemic that we will face afterwards. There is also an interesting age variation in terms of what we should prioritize. So with the young, who of course vote very differently from the old, focusing on social change and social progress, and older people tending to focus on economic progress. So again, some of those divisions, of course, reflected in our politics. We aren't united. And indeed, we have a survey out today with King's College that shows that the British are divided even over whether or not we're divided. So we do face some challenges. But overall, I think what, in terms of the agenda for people on this call, the difficulty is that it's exposed the existing inequalities that we already had. It's often made them worse. People like me living in a nice house have tended to have a reasonable pandemic. And it's very different in a few neighborhoods, just a few streets away from where I live. It's interesting that the vaccine has saved us. And so science has actually worked. And actually, faith in science and in medicine has actually held up throughout the pandemic. Trust in government peaked in April. It then fell back. But overall, it's about roughly where it would normally be expected to be. There's been no collapse in faith in science or indeed even in government with the vaccines helping. And I think the main challenges we face now is that it does to me look like a K-shaped recovery, with some people able to have bounce back in their spending after with the money that they've saved, but with a lot of people with diminished savings and health problems. We've got unprotected budgets identified by the Institute for Fiscal Studies, with local government facing real terms cuts as we go forward. So it seems to me that we have all the old problems and some new ones. But the only thing I would finally say is that, you know, the public is absolutely behind having the money there to do the right thing. And with that, I will shut up. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Ben. Lots there, raises lots of questions, I guess. Please encourage those of you to put those questions into the Q&A, and we will return to hopefully quiz you, Ben, on some of that. But we'll first next hand over to Professor Linda Bold, who's Professor of Public Health and Co-Director of the Usher Institute at Edinburgh University. Over to you, Linda.
Thank you very much, Janelle. And thanks to Katrina, who's sharing my slides. I thought it was very important that somebody who followed Professor Whitty was actually saying next slide. So that's what I'm going to do. So I'm going to cover a little bit on the context, which everyone on this call is very familiar with. But I'm also going to focus then on what we know from some of the surveys, different ones from those that Ben has presented from Ipsos Mori, and also other data about compliance, going into a bit more detail. I will make some similar points to Ben, how these differ between groups, and then actually what do we know in more detail about trust in government and also sources of information. And then for the last couple of minutes, I'm going to make a few comments about how we could improve communication and both nationally, devolved nations, and also importantly for this meeting, locally. Next slide. So everyone is familiar now with the timeline of what we've been through in the UK over the last year. The ways that the public has been asked to change their behaviour are really substantial, and they've been long lasting. The restrictions on movement, as Chris was saying, social interaction, and all the wider harms that the pandemic has caused. I think we're only now beginning to understand the broader impacts, and they will be studied for many years to come. And there's also been important questions asked, I know, by yourselves and by others across the country, regarding whether the public would comply with restrictions, how long that compliance would last, or how comprehensive it would be. And I actually think that there isn't actually much evidence that this concept of behavioral fatigue was something discussed by my behavioral science colleagues or the social scientists advising government, but probably came from somewhere else. I think we had a lot of faith that the public would be able to change their behavior, given the resilience that we know that we have, despite the big inequalities. Next slide. So again, you're all very familiar with the analysis that's now being done on excess mortality, and it is very positive to hear today from the ONS that in terms of excess deaths, we're now below what, for the first time since early September, what we would expect looking at the five-year average. But retrospectively, it's pretty clear that the UK has suffered very badly. And you will have seen this analysis from the ONS that was updated last week, just comparing us with other countries in Europe. And it's clear now that the first wave, we had the highest levels of excess mortality in Europe, and that England was harder hit than the other devolved nations, but not big differences. And then in the second wave, other countries in Europe seem to have had a worse experience than we have. But it is worth emphasizing that people in the 20% most deprived parts of England, for example, were twice as likely to die from COVID. So we have these differences both when you compare us to our neighbors and also within the country. And an interesting point, which I think requires further research, is the highest rates of excess mortality in the under 65s, were observed in the UK in both waves, except for Bulgaria and the second wave. And the reasons for this are really not clear, so we're going to need to look at that in more detail. Next slide. So a few points on compliance, and many of you will be familiar, if not all of you, with the UCL COVID social study, which is a fantastic resource. And thanks very much to Daisy and Andrew and colleagues for allowing me to show some of their data. And what you can see here is that the common experience nationally has been of people following guidelines consistently and trying their best to do so. And the reasons why they didn't were not about protest and not wanting to follow the guidance, but more about exposure and reasons, quite valid reasons why it wasn't always possible. And you can see that the majority compliance, which is doing most of the things the government's asked or public health agencies have asked a person to do most of the time, has remained high. It really didn't decline significantly at any point in the pandemic. A complete compliance was more difficult for people in the summer months and has risen again to almost the levels of the spring as we headed into, unfortunately, the second really severe period of restrictions that we're just emerging from now. Next slide. There are, however, these differences between groups, and there's dozens of charts in the COVID social study. These reports are released every couple of weeks, but you can see that it has been much harder for younger adults to adopt complete compliance, probably for very valid reasons in many cases. The kinds of restrictions that have been imposed on their normal social activities are really very difficult for them to follow, in contrast to perhaps older people. And of course, the opportunities they've lost as well. And then in terms of exposure, people who are in essential roles, obviously it's much more difficult for them as well. And you see that women are more likely to comply generally than men. People with children in the household find it harder to follow complete compliance than those without. And actually people in urban areas are less likely to completely comply. And that's been the case throughout. So there are really important differences here. Next slide. And then I just thought I'd include a couple or one slide from Scotland. Some of the legend is missing from this, so I'll just go through it. So there are differences between the devolved nations, and they're quite subtle in relation to a whole variety of measures during the pandemic. But you can see here that the first point is about clarity. So the proportion who think that advice from the Scottish government is clear and helpful, and you can see that's remained pretty high throughout. It's gone down a little bit. And then the dashed line, which just starts to emerge from September there, public support, the percentage who support how the restrictions are being handled. The line at the bottom where the legend has disappeared that starts with 13% is the proportion who find it hard, who agree that I'm finding it hard to always stick to government guidelines. And you can see that's a minority, but it has risen through time. And then the last dotted line along the top was acceptance. So the proportion who agree that the best thing to do is to follow government advice. So what you see there is an interesting gap between clarity and support, and also the opinion or the view that the right thing to do is to follow the advice, even if it isn't always easy to do so. Next slide. And then interesting differences across the nations, and I'm going to go on to this briefly when I talk about communication. Confidence in government has been consistently higher in Scotland for whatever reason. And I think it may be something to do with communication from this government here, and also to some extent higher in Wales, definitely, than it has been in England. So those are differences in confidence. And then I just included, because I think it's interesting, the activities that people have missed during the first period of restrictions in the spring, and then looking at the second period that we've just been through now. And you can see in general that people have got used to things. They're less likely to miss things in the second period, but you can see that the impact on interaction, quite understandably, with friends and families is the biggest loss that people report in terms of their personal lives that they've experienced, setting aside issues to do with employment and education. Next slide. The other point, just final point I wanted to make on compliance, is there are multiple ways of measuring this. You all remember from the number 10 briefings in the early days, we had all those mobility data we were being shown. But you can see that in terms of the restrictions that we're just emerging from now, average daily contacts between people not in the same household have reduced significantly in Scotland. And that is also the case when you look at the data for England. So in general, my message is that we read in the newspaper that, you know, there's lots of non-compliance, that the public have failed at various points. They've requested tests and overwhelmed the system in the September, despite being told for months that they should get a test if they've had symptoms. Students have been blamed for antisocial behavior when they were required to go back to university and live in shared accommodation. So there's been lots of points where I think we've not covered ourselves in glory in terms of the finger pointing. And I don't mean our sector, public health, local government. I just mean the public discourse has been unhelpful. The take home message is the British public have been through a huge amount and they've tried their absolute best to adjust their behavior. Next slide. So I just wanted to spend a couple of minutes in the last minute or two I have on communication. Now, this is work that was produced by colleagues in Independent Sage. For the last few months, I've been on one of their subgroups, the Behavioral Science Group. And this just, I'm not going to go through all the details, but this is available on the Independent Sage website. There's a little bit of humor in here as well. It just looks at some of the different messaging. And I think I would argue from a behavioral science perspective that the communication has not been brilliant consistently from government. And you can see that people's understanding, again, if you wish to look back, these slides will be available, as we heard at the beginning, on the detail here. You can see that understanding of guidance has lessened through time as rules have become more complicated and the messaging has been unclear. And we have had unfortunate incidents during the last few months where high profile figures have not followed guidance. That is not unique to the UK. There's been incidences in New Zealand, Austria, Germany, and others where people have had to resign. And that undermines trust in government and in the guidance. And that's very clear, in fact, from work again that colleagues at UCL did, looking at what happened with the Dominic Cummings incident. So how can we improve the communication? Just to emphasize this, I think both at local government and national level, just five brief points I'm going to make because I know I'm running out of time. We should try and be precise and clear in our messaging, make sure that the messages are easy to enact and to adhere to. The messaging should be irony resistant. I think the phrase stay alert, there was quite a bit of irony around that. We wish to avoid that. We should also avoid branding or sloganeering, and that should not come at the price of clarity and precision. And messaging should be underpinned by evidence about what is effective. And again, you can find some of that detail in the paper. And then final point, and you are experts in this, it is about engagement with our local diverse communities and making sure that the communication is tailored and is appropriate to them. So last one or two slides, next one. And this was just to make the point that trust in terms of different information sources has been varied. And as Ben already said, actually trust in scientists, clinicians, other experts has remained high. Trust in government has declined throughout the period and politicians. And there's also been high trust in people that we know and also others in our communities. So that's varied. Next slide. And then just finally, I just wanted to emphasize some of the social impacts, which we don't have time to go into now, but there's multiple data sources on this in the UK. And you can see that life satisfaction has declined, quite understandably, at a general population level throughout the pandemic. We've already heard about levels of anxiety and depression. And looking ahead, the public in Great Britain are divided in terms of when they think more normality will return to our lives, with around 30% of adults believing that it will return to normal in 6 months or less. And this is cut off the text. So 21% now believing it's going to take more than a year. So everyone in the country is looking ahead. And on that point, I think final slide from me, or one before last, just to highlight the excellent report published today by the British Academy, looking at the longer term. So I think Chris actually said that there will be a long shadow and we need to think and realize that in local government, in public health, obviously, and with all our colleagues, we'll be working to address this for the foreseeable future. So it's a long road ahead, but many positive things I think that we can also emphasize. So final slide was just to use the local motto from where I live in Edinburgh here in Leith. And that's about perseverance, which I think, 1 year on from these restrictions being applied to the population, we have done that. And, you know, I think, again, that's something that we can be positive about. Thank you.
Thanks, Linda. And it's great to see the, I think the importance of behavioral science being used as evidence about how we actually can address COVID, the pandemic, isn't it? And I think that's certainly something that has come much more to the fore over the year. So it'd be interesting to have your thoughts afterwards. But encourage people to put a Q&A for us to come to after Cordelia has spoken. So Cordelia Hay is an associate at Britain Thinks. Over to you, Cordelia, for a 10-minute presentation. And then, as I say, we'll go to Q&A with the panel.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Janelle. So my presentation very much echoes what we've heard already from Ben and Linda, but tries to look a little bit about the impacts of the pandemic on communities and civic participation and what opportunities you have from local government to harness some renewed appetite for civic participation, perhaps. The background to this presentation is some work that we conducted with the Local Government Association in late 2020, which was really taking a qualitative rather than quantitative approach to understand public opinion and behaviour and the extent to which this has changed as a result of the pandemic. So the full report is published on the LGA website. There's lots more detail than I've been able to cram in here. But specifically, we were looking to do two things. Firstly, understand the extent to which public attitudes and behaviours have changed as a result of COVID-19. And then secondly, to look at how the public now defines local and what that means to them in the context of the pandemic and any changes in their attitudes to civic participation. Where relevant, I've also peppered through some of our own research at Britain Thinks that we've conducted over the course of the pandemic, a qualitative longitudinal study called the Coronavirus Diaries. It was initially going to be a 3-week project that we started a year ago today, and here we are still doing it with no end in sight. So just in terms of some key points that I'm going to bring out over the course of the presentation that very much echo what we've already heard. Firstly, the public mood is still pretty low, even in the context of the very successful vaccine rollout. There's a real sense of despondency, and most people are really focusing on the day to day rather than daring to hope too much and seeing their plans dashed again. That sense of kind of moving goalposts that we saw over the course of last year has really limited people's ability to look too far ahead into the future. The pandemic has impacted everyone, but the change experience has been far from universal, and we think this is a really important point to keep bringing out. And some people actually really struggle to see much that's different about their lives beyond government mandated behaviours. In their own words, people in communities just want to get back to normal. That's a phrase we hear again and again in our research. That will mean different things to different people. But what's really important there is that what people are not saying spontaneously is, let's build back better. So that build back better narrative that's becoming increasingly common in policy circles isn't necessarily intuitive. It isn't necessarily what the public are saying they want. But it is met with some support when it's introduced, particularly when it's rooted in fairness. And I'll come on to this in a moment. The things that people want to change most about their communities are typically long lasting. They're typically things that outdate the pandemic. But taking action on them and civic participation in general often feels out of reach for a few key reasons. Once civic participation is brought to life, though, with examples, with case studies, there is significant interest in hearing more, and in particular about opportunities to get involved digitally in the current context, along with offline alternatives. So just to bring a bit of the data, qualitative and quantitative, to life on this. So these word clouds show how the mood of our coronavirus diarists have changed over time. So we're just under a year ago here on the far left to our most recent wave in February of this year. And what you can see is a real evolution in the public mood from anxiety back in April last year through to relief last summer when there was sort of a respite or even an end, some people thought, in sight. And then a real growing sense of frustration, tiredness, a small hope there in the final word cloud, but a real reluctance for people to allow their hopes to get up too much. And we find that many are focusing on the day to day and really waiting for burdens to be relieved rather than hoping for the end. Since in April last year, this is going to be over in a few weeks. a sense at the end of last year that 2021 was a huge threshold and where life would go get back to normal. Then in February, a real sense that actually that was very much not going to be the case. And people talked a lot about just treading water till it's over. This comment here from a parent with school-aged children who was feeling particularly stressed at the time, saying, I can't see an end to it. It feels like it's lasted so long. I've just got to go with it. If you think too much about the future, then you're only going to be disappointed. The pandemic has impacted everyone, but as we've already heard, the changes experienced have been far from universal. So some people report experiencing major changes to the way they live, work and travel. Anyone who works in an office job will have seen very major impacts to the way that they work. Anyone with school-aged children will have had huge disruption over the past year. But others actually describe experiencing relatively little change to their lives as a result of the pandemic. And that's really important to stress. If you're someone, and presumably many of us are, if we're online at a conference, who work in offices, it's really easy to believe that everyone's going through the same thing. But actually, for people who work in more manual jobs or on the front line, who've been going out to work, actually their life may not have changed so much. And really the key thing that might have changed in their life is about reduced social contact with family and friends. Reflecting this variety in impact, while some behavioural changes that people describe have been wide-reaching, others really vary across the population. So actually, really, the only universal changes seem to be the ones that are government mandated and specifically related to the pandemic. Restrictions on social contact, which has been challenging for pretty much everyone, but particularly those living alone, and hygiene and mask wearing, again, a sort of added mental load for people at an already stressful time. But some of the other behaviour changes that people have reported in their lives are very uneven. So some people talk about increased time. Some people have reduced their car usage and gone and reduced their use of public transport. But some people haven't and have been going out to work throughout the whole time of this pandemic. When looking to the future, people consistently speak to a desire to get back to normal, and they speak actually very conveniently to the key things on Linda's chart that people are missing, around socialising in person, resuming leisure activities and travel, but actually a sense that there aren't rules to abide by, and the sense that those rules aren't going to change immediately in the future. When we get people to do a guided fantasy exercise to imagine, you know, what getting back to normal feels like, actually the key thing they often talk about is not having to worry about the rules and what they can and can't do. When prompted, there is appetite to build back better. I think it's really important to stress, because this phrase is coming up a lot in sort of policy circles. It isn't a phrase that's coming from the general public themselves. But when you prompt and you probe on this phrase of build back better, there is some appetite for that. And there is particular appetite in building back more fairly across key areas of British society. And people point to all sorts of things here, but particularly the points on the left. They point to more fairness for key workers, particularly NHS workers, but actually for many, this pandemic has really helped them realise the diversity of key workers that are out there, and some of those essential workers that aren't necessarily employed by the public sector. A real renewed focus on mental health, social inequality and geographic equality, education, unemployment and climate change. When people are asked about priorities for their communities, they tend to focus on more long-standing issues, including but not limited to local infrastructure, particularly roads. I'm afraid that even in a pandemic, people love talking about potholes. I think the apocalypse would need to happen for people to not like talking about potholes when they talk about issues in their local area. Antisocial behaviour is often a very, very common theme. Rundown town centres, something often exacerbated by the pandemic, and a lack of community spirit. And these factors often far predate the pandemic. Often there's a sense of these are long-standing issues in my community that haven't been addressed for too long. Though some feel lockdown may have worsened some of these factors, for example, when they think about their town centres, or drawn attention to these issues, potentially if they're spending more time in their local areas. However, most people feel they have relatively limited scope to make changes to their local area and to address these issues. Most aren't sure what civic participation is, both by that phrase and in general, or how to create change in their local area themselves. And most feel they haven't really participated in any change locally beyond small individual actions that people aren't quite sure whether they merit being called civic participation or not. For example, choosing to shop locally, which is something that lots of people describe doing in the pandemic. The minority who've taken more active steps to engage in their local area and to affect change are often those either with something to react against, some reacting against some planning permission happening in their local area or a development they don't feel happy with, a personal interest in a specific issue, or often more ties to their community, particularly those with children. And the public really point to two key barriers to civic participation, which they saw both in general and still as being true in the context of the pandemic. The first is a lack of information about how to participate and who to engage with, often underpinned by an assumption that change cannot be enacted alone and there's something going on that they need to get involved with. And the second factor was an assumed need for regular commitment. Many feel that they need real time to participate in things going on in their local area and to affect change. And that feels like quite a big ask for people in a very uncertain climate. We heard particularly those from lower socioeconomic grades describing real concern about their job feeling incredibly precarious and feeling they should be placing all of their attention on that in the current environment rather than thinking about civic participation. In addition, we heard some other barriers, including physical barriers to participation as a result of illness or disability, but also negative previous experiences of aiming to enact change in the local area and people being very burnt by previous experiences where they felt that they hadn't had much impact. In the context of low knowledge then, in our research with the LGA, we shared a presentation with participants introducing some pretty high level information on civic participation. You can see a couple of excerpts on the right. It covered several key areas about the role of councils, councillors and consultations, and used some case studies to highlight how these can work in practice. So the low traffic neighbourhoods initiatives in Hackney, the Saving Darlington Library project and the Friends of Alexandra Park in Manchester. And on balance, we found that this information goes a long way to bring to life what civic participation looks like and options for getting involved. It raised awareness of ways of participating and made achieving change feel like more of a possibility for this audience. People particularly took out opportunities for community groups to work with local authorities to maintain and improve services wasn't necessarily something that many knew that the general public could get involved with. The option to contact their local councillor to discuss issues in their community and take action, and consultation processes that seek to hear from many individuals in the community in a way that doesn't necessarily seem time consuming. Again, something that many weren't aware of. And across those examples, it was really the case studies that helped to bring the process of change to life. So looking ahead, many call for more information and simple, accessible opportunities to be involved. In particular, the communities that we heard from said that several key areas stood out as priorities for consultation and participation, issues relating to housing and affordable housing, changes to road layouts and pedestrianisation, which was quite front of mind for some people in the context of the pandemic and those things happening, closures that might impact local businesses and closures to other services, for example, hospitals and libraries. For many, participating online is viewed as a simple and easy way to participate in change, provided that offline alternatives are provided for those without access. So there's a desire for websites or other online tools where individuals can find out about ongoing consultations and issues in their area. Some also highlight the existence of platforms such as Nextdoor, which they find helpful for these purposes and wonder if local authorities could be doing more to harness. So to wrap up, we wonder if there are four key opportunities to consider. The first is, what opportunities are there for highlighting the impact of individual actions on communities to demonstrate that participation doesn't need to be large scale or group based, and to reflect the ways that people feel that they're already taking action, particularly in the context of the pandemic, where some of that group-based action is actually incredibly difficult or inadvisable from a public health perspective. And people do feel that they're taking small actions to try and help their local area. For example, shopping local is something that feels really tangible to people as a way they could be making a difference to their local economy. Secondly, what opportunities are there to demonstrate the full range of ways in which people can get involved, including both digital and non-digital methods, to show that civic participation doesn't need to be arduous or time-consuming and may be happening on some of the platforms on which communities are already engaging, like Nextdoor? Thirdly, what opportunities are there to bring to life what civic participation can look like? by using councillors to disseminate the message. I kid you not, some people were very surprised to find out that councillors actually live in their local area. They assumed that they were like politicians that live far away and aren't actually based in their community and don't necessarily live around the corner. And what opportunities are there to use case studies and real life examples from communities to bring those to life? Finally, what opportunities are there to create appetite for civic participation and for change through this frame of Build Back Better, which I feel is going to be with us for some time? Really noting that for the public, it's about fairness, that the part of that sort of narrative that's particularly compelling. A really key watch out here for local government is going to be ensuring that this isn't positioned as counter to the public's own priority of getting back to normal, but rather as complementary. Is there almost something in there about a better normal than we had before? So I will stop sharing my screen now.
That's fascinating, Cordelia. Thanks so much, because it really moves us on and forward, doesn't it? And I wonder whether getting back to normal is about you as an individual, whereas building back better is somehow about groups, or it's a different thing. You're comparing individuals with groups. But that and other questions for the panel. So if I invite Linda and Ben back on, and we've got questions, and I encourage them to come through. But one of them, and something about how we frame our messages, which might, Cordelia, be about that, how it relates to you as an individual as opposed to society or the group, and whether slogans resonate in that way, whether that's different. How we frame between hope and it's not over yet, and does it matter? Does it actually affect our behavior, whether it's framed as a hope thing and just keep going and obey the rules, as opposed to it's not over, please obey the rules. Does that framing make a difference? So should we start there? I don't know. Ben, do you want to start with that, and we'll go Ben, Linda, and then Cordelia?
Sure. I mean, I think people are now cautious, and given the risks of a third wave, which Chris identified, even because the vaccine isn't 100% efficient, I think you don't want to tell everybody it's all fine. I think you want to use the caution that people have. I think in terms of the last mile of vaccination, we've talked about the framing of vaccination. And I think making it a sort of public duty is a really important thing to do, that it's not just for yourself, that you're actually doing it for your neighborhood. And one thing that I did think about that, and some very interesting questions, that there's always been vaccine hesitancy, which of course is true. But I think as we get, as we are trying to get to 100% quite quickly, or as high as we can, I think this is where, particularly for local government, and I've seen this work in other contexts, even in much more less important things in some ways, like recycling, people want to know how their bit of the council, their ward, their neighborhood, their street is doing. And so if you can start to show that virtually everybody on this street has now had it, it's now time for you to do it, that type of messaging has been proven to be pretty effective. And on the work done on getting people to pay your council, to pay their tax bills and tax arrears on time, telling people not just that most people had now paid up, but actually most people in your town had paid up, that turned out in very large scale tests to be most effective. So I think as we start to focus on particular communities and particularly neighborhoods, it's going to be that. And that's where, of course, local government will come into its own, working with the NHS.
Thanks, Ben. Linda.
I agree with all of that. I think I guess I'd make a couple of points there. If we focus on vaccine uptake as the key example, I think the first one is data. So we do need, as you have locally, pretty good data to identify where there are gaps in your community. So where is there an uptake issue and where is there not? Because clearly there's not been an uptake issue in some of the older groups that we've seen so far, but it's going to become more challenging and we do definitely have gaps. So that's the first thing, because then you can tailor your messaging. I think Ben's right, channeling a message of social solidarity, and it's well established in public health communications. If it's perceived as a social norm, this is a behavior that most people engage in, or alternatively, a behavior that most people avoid, then that's something that people do, is believable and is salient for people. The other thing is we probably need a mixture between gain-framed and loss-framed messaging. So if we have groups who are hesitant for very good reasons, and there is an excellent report from the British Council actually on vaccine hesitancy, in case that's of interest to people, which goes through a lot of this literature. So gain framed is essentially saying, what are you going to gain by the vaccination? And loss frame is, what will you lose if you're not vaccinated? And those will be different types of gains and losses for different groups, for young people, for people in particular ethnic minority communities, for others. So it's thinking about what are the right messages for the different groups in your society. And there's not a simple way to communicate this. There's not a single message that works for everyone. Thanks.
Thanks, and Cordelia.
I think that to sort of the way you initially asked the question, Janelle, there's perhaps not necessarily, it's not necessarily mutually exclusive to sort of be pragmatic and optimistic. I think that the public, as I tried to get across, have grown very tired of sort of moving goalposts, and this has led them to sort of take any signs that things might be over or things might be looking more hopeful with some skepticism. But to shamelessly steal something that someone has said in the Q&A, someone who is really cutting through and does seem to be striking this balance is Professor Van Tam, who actually has been using very sort of simple, believable analogies to help bring to life where we're at in the pandemic, and help sort of ground this in a combination of sort of pragmatism and optimism. It's very much about not wasting all of the great progress that we've made and the very difficult sacrifices that people have had to make. And that's something that kind of really plays to that. His sort of football match analogies, I don't know enough about football to repeat them, unfortunately, but his football match analogies have really sort of helped to ground it in I guess, something that people can understand and believe in and relate to.
But that's interesting, isn't it? Because so you're right, but I suppose it resonates with people who understand and believe and excited about football. So there are questions, some great questions coming in, aren't there? But there is something about how do you communicate to different groups who might have different interests, different life experiences with something like that. And, you know, the questions do go into that. And I suppose, so there's both, how do you communicate to different groups who have different life experiences, using the football analogy? And I suppose, what's the balance then between national communication that has to be quite, you know, all encompassing, or just, you know, not very nuanced, with local communication? So how important is it that we do communicate locally? I mean, what's the balance there? And, you know, how much energy and effort should we put into our local communications with our communities, or does it all get ground out anyway by national communication?
Well, you're more, you know, local government, everybody on the call knows that local government is far more trusted than national government, and local councillors are far more trusted than politicians. So although that's not perhaps saying much, given how bad ratings of trust in national politicians are. So I think there's a huge task for local authorities to now actually, as we start to do the last mile on the vaccine, to really start ramping up the messaging, finding people who are connected in the community, working with churches, going on to, so, you know, getting, we need, I would love to see a social media meme come out of local government, either on YouTube or Facebook, about, you know, the people having the vaccine. So it'll be, get all your local personalities and celebrities, get them jabbed, film them doing it. All of that will matter, I think, in the last mile.
Yeah, and just to add, I mean, local radio is a very powerful tool. You know, different types of local media, I think, can be used. And again, building on what we know from broader public health campaigns, having that tailored local messaging, I think is very valuable. Yeah, so I would agree with that. I also think that, you know, just to, again, give credit to some of the directors of public health who've been very active in local and national media, they're really seen as credible communicators in this pandemic. We've had a couple of, just to use, you know, focus on Scotland, we've had a couple of outstanding examples up here who regularly used by, for example, BBC Scotland, and I think listen to far more than some, certainly than the politicians. So I think it is about identifying you. The other thing I would say, and this is maybe something Cordelia would want to come back to, is there are people who have better communication skills than others. It's just an innate thing. Some people have that skill, like some people are better at reading a map and all kinds of different things. We're all different as human beings. I think Professor Van Tam just is a really good communicator. So finding those people again locally that have that ability and choosing them, I think, they don't need to be celebrities, but can be, is a good technique. Thanks.
Cordelia.
It's been said already, but I think local communication is going to be very important to make this feel relatable. There's a bit of a risk that at the national level, it feels disconnected from what people are experiencing. And of course, we all talked about how experiences of the pandemic have been unequal, and geographic inequality has been such a huge driver as well of very, very, very unequal experiences of the pandemic. And you can really feel the anger and the frustration when you're hearing from communities where actually there's been very little respite from restrictions over the past year, communities in Leicester and parts of the Northwest, and actually reflecting that kind of local experience is incredibly important rather than that blanket national message. So absolutely agree.
Yeah, and that's certainly my experience in Tameside, where we've now unfortunately entered the top 10, but we've certainly been restricted in Greater Manchester for very much longer, and you can really feel that. The social media element is interesting, isn't it? Because it does enable you to have that local sensitivity with local voices. If we include WhatsApp groups and all sorts, they're not just Twitter. So there's question in there about BAME groups, where that particularly I think is being well used. Some interesting question here about brand perception and how we're thinking about perceptions of Pfizer, where some people didn't want Pfizer, they wanted the British AZ, and then when things were a bit dodgy with AZ perhaps, they didn't want AZ. Unclear about origins of Moderna. There was a question earlier to Chris Whitty, wasn't there, about should we have our own supply of vaccine. Does that make a difference? ? And then if I can just add in another question as well on some of the slogans, so the branding or the slogans and the Build Back Better, might that be picked up by populist voices? Cordelia, perhaps if we start with you, I mean, how does that sort of populism around a brand, the British brand or the Build Back Better link with the civic participation points you were making?
Yeah, I think the key thing about the Build Back Better sort of message is it feels like, there's a lot of people jostling for that territory at the moment. A lot of people in sort of policy circles are talking about it. And when you speak to real people, there's certainly some receptiveness to the phrase, but it's not necessarily something ordinary people are going around and saying to each other, oh, I wish we'd build that better. For them, it's very much about getting back to normal. And actually, I think if local authorities really want to show that they understand their communities and their priorities, actually reflecting a bit of that language back to them is going to be very important. As I sort of tried to say at the end of the presentation, not going too hard on, let's have a green revolution. There's some appetite for green recovery, but actually if you make it too much about change, then you will not be seen to be listening to what people really want. And that really is that sense of normality back in their lives. So of course that will look different for different people. So with any of those sort of brands and slogans, and we've got very obsessed with three word slogans lately, haven't we? The best thing is to make sure it's really rooted in something that people feel themselves. And actually the more authentic it can be, the more likely it's going to be to resonate and engender the change or get across the message that you're trying to achieve.
Minda.
I don't have much to say on the slogans, except again from a public health messaging perspective, looking at the literature on this, it is easier to have simple phrases that people can recognize and understand and repeat. That certainly is the case, rather than something that's more complex. Just on the vaccines question, on the branding, I think there is a genuine issue around choice, and also, so I've had a lot of questions about why am I not going to know which vaccine I receive? And the response to that has been, well, we are trying to provide access to everyone. These are safe and effective vaccines. It doesn't matter which one you get. That's the appropriate public health response. However, you then get questions about, well, I want to be able to read, the patient information leaflet for the vaccine that I'm receiving in advance and want to know more about it, which might be a more viable question. And then the final point is just the vaccine nationalism. Obviously, I think, you know, anecdotal reports of people wanting the Oxford one because it's made in the UK. And then alternatively, the very clear evidence from some of the polling this week that Europeans don't want the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine at the moment for a variety of other reasons. That's quite dangerous. And I think it's very important that we try and move away from some view of one brand being better than another, while recognizing, I think, the valid questions about where do I obtain information about, you know, what I've just received or am about to receive.
Linda, can I follow that up before going to Ben then? What does the general public think about making the vaccine mandatory then?
Does that question for me?
Well, yeah, unless Ben, you've actually asked, the public.
I think
do you know the answer?
Yeah, from memory, it's about 6 in 10 support mandatory vaccines.
And is that stratified?
Yes, well, of course, you get the same pattern that you get on vaccines. So younger working class people and people from ethnically diverse backgrounds who are obviously more resistant to the vaccine. I mean, it was interesting seeing some of the comments and the questions where one authority is using local imams and celebrities, but of course, they're getting backlash from inside the community. And I think one thing that I was just reflecting on the lessons of this year, and one is that which we saw in Brexit, we saw in the crash, is that rational people telling people facts is not on its own persuasive. And we've just seen that again. And even when people say things that are factually completely or believe things that are insane, I mean, I've been dealing with people on social media who believe that Ipsos Mori stands for they die. And I am somehow involved. We're obviously doing large scale testing and somehow we're part of a conspiracy to extract everybody's DNA and then pass control of them to Bill Gates or something. And I mean, I've been engaging with some of these people. And I think what's clear, and I think this is important, is that a lot of the evidence on this now is that you can't just tell people that's just not true. You almost have to listen, ask them why they think that. And I think that, which of course takes time, because if you just tell people you're nuts, which is my first reaction when I'm told that I'm part of a conspiracy to kill millions of people, it just doesn't work. So I think there's some real nuance there, but I think ultimately we have to engage people, and we're only going to get the last mile if we are out there, you know, resources are tight, time is tight, but that's what it's going to be. And that, of course, is exactly the roots of the public health community. But this is going to test us in a way that we haven't been tested for a long time.
Thanks, Ben. So I'll turn to Linda and then Cordelia for the last word, because we're just wrapping up and we wanted to finish early so that people can mark the time of a year of COVID and those who've lost their lives. But we have that really, really difficult memory, this huge milestone. But what, you know, how do we go forward in terms of feeling part of something that's building pragmatic hope, as it were? Linda and then Cordelia.
So I think that the data shows from the past year that there is this resilience, but also that we do have a sense of solidarity, not across all groups, but the collective effort, the collective behavioural effort, I think is something we should continue to emphasise, and also emphasise the positive, as in what has been achieved. And that's multiple. It's not just the vaccines and treatments, etc. There's multiple things as well. So focusing on the positive. The other thing I would comment on, and it's another question in the box, for particularly for public health and local government, is really having that narrative about the autumn and the winter and winter preparedness. So I think we haven't heard much about this. I know you're thinking about it, but I don't think the public is thinking about it. Mm-hmm. So I think having the positive while alongside saying, but this is what is likely to happen, and we're going to have to continue planning for outbreaks and, you know, a surge on demand for the NHS, etc., in the coming months.
Thanks. And Cordelia?
I mean, this anniversary of lockdown does potentially present a bit of opportunity to remind people of some of the things that they sort of found as unexpected silver linings of the initial lockdown. You know, we saw that in the first lockdown. Actually, a lot of people found unexpected positives, and that's really tailed off as lockdowns have continued and gone on. So is there an opportunity actually to help bring back to life some of those initial silver linings that people found and felt quite positive about? I think the other point there is just really understanding people and understanding communities and breaking them down. I think there was an excellent comment about it's quite dangerous to talk about BAME people in general, and actually there needs to be a lot more work breaking down people from different ethnic minority backgrounds to better understand some of the barriers to uptake of vaccine and other behaviours and messages cutting through. It's not large sample sizes, but we've certainly done some work which surfaces some quite key differences between the Black and Asian communities, and more work in that area I think is really, really important to understand communities and therefore the messages that they need to hear.
And what Ben was saying in terms of why people think what they're thinking. And it's that real understanding of people, communities, that we can then help them, support them to kind of move on in a positive way. Brilliant. Well, thanks so much for your input, panel. Really appreciate it. Thanks, everyone. Look forward to having you this afternoon in the webinar, which starts at 2. And we'll end there to enable us, if you chose, to have the minutes silence. Thanks very much. Bye now.